Baldy's breakdowns here on the Sports Bash 97.3 ESPN. Check out the hashtag at Baldy Breakdowns, at Baldy NFL, NFL Network, Fox College Football. You can hear him talking football everywhere here on the Sports Bash now on 97.3 ESPN. Another impressive night last night, Baldy. You know, it's hard sometimes when you have that layoff and everyone's talking about you as the toast of the town. Now, they got off to a sloppy start, but there was a lot of character there to come back and, you know, win a primetime game at home against a division team the way they did.
Well, it was impressive. And, you know, it always – it's, you know, I mean, the quarterback gives you a chance every week. And it didn't take long. I mean, they you know, the touchdown to Mac Collins was just a thing of beauty. I mean, it was designed to go to Mac Collins. It was designed to get him, you know, matched up against DJ Swearinger. They got the matchup. I mean, it was, you know, it was protection. It was design. It was execution. And from that moment on, I mean, that offense clicked. And look, he rescues them when they don't play well on first and second down. He rescues them on third down, whether it's a scramble, whether it's a Houdini act, or whether it's just a pinpoint throw. I mean, third down is where they have made their money in this win streak and in this season so far, and they've been remarkable at it.
Today, Peterson brought up the Agholor touchdown. He said that was an audible at the line of scrimmage based on what he saw there. And how much does a second-year guy typically get that, you know, ability to go up there and do what he wants to do and seemingly have input on plays? It seems that he's farther along than most guys at this stage of their careers.
Yeah, he is. He is much further along. And, you know, there's some guys. I mean, Matt Ryan could do it in his second year, and there's guys that have done it. But he's doing it, and he's doing it, you know, at a record pace right now. He's a record pace on third downs. He's the touchdowns, the splash plays. You know, he's just stronger than and just so explosive. We just don't see quarterbacks. We see great athletes that have been quarterbacks, but not the combination that he has between his physical strength, his explosiveness, his competitiveness, you know, obviously the overall football IQ that he has to take the game over and to make that type of a check. John Gruden talked about it last night. I mean, all those things combined, you know, makes him a rare guy right now in this business. And, you know, this is just 23 starts in the NFL, and we're already talking about him as the league MVP candidate. I mean, he's an exceptionally advanced student, and each week he gets another opportunity to take a test and show us just how advanced he is.
Brian Baldinger is with us, Baldy Breakdowns. Check him out on Twitter at Baldy NFL. You can see him break down a lot of these plays that were big last night. And as you tweeted, he's getting more difficult to defend. If you try to spy him in man coverage, he reads it very well. Plus, what he does with his feet and his escapability was a problem all night last night for Washington.
It is. Now, you know, there is a danger. There is a danger to all of it. I mean, he's a rare athlete, and you know, I mean, I've seen everybody from Clay Matthews jump on his back to Cameron Wake to the entire defensive front of the Redskins, and he's coming out of it. But, you know, as Aaron Rodgers showed you, like none of these guys, and Andrew Luck has showed you, none of these guys are invincible. And, you know, there is some caution here to getting out of the pocket and creating all the magic that he's doing. It just takes one awkward fall the wrong way right now, and everybody's susceptible to the type of injuries that, you know, we're seeing around the league. So there is some caution to it, but, you know, you can't take that out of him right now. That's who he is. That's the way he played the game at North Dakota State. It's the way he played in high school, and, you know, he's playing it like that now. But, you know, I mean, teams are seeing that the Eagles are not good in pass protection when it comes to running backs. They're finding different ways to get, you know, good players, defensive linemen on running backs right now. So it's just something that they're going to have to, you know, constantly work at and tweak to try to improve as the season goes on. But for the time being, he is just fantastic to watch.
Baldy, what made the touchdown pass to Corey Clement so special?
Well, Mason Foster hit him right in the chest, you know, like right in the chest when he threw that ball. So it's pinpoint accurate as he's getting jolted by the starting middle linebacker of the Redskins. The location was phenomenal. The great catch by Corey Clement, too. Just a great catch. I mean, he's got to get his feet in bounds. He's got to twist his body around. He's got to do all those things. So it's a great catch. But the throw, most guys that get hit like that and jolted like that, they can't keep a ball on a straight line. The ball's going to get popped up. It's going to sail on them. Something's going to happen to the trajectory of the ball. And nothing happened to the trajectory. I mean, it's just uncanny to have something like that happen. I mean, Kirk Cousins got hit by Brandon Graham on his throwing arm, and, you know, the next thing you know, Corey Graham has an interception. But his balls aren't getting intercepted when he's getting hit. The ball's going where he wants to go, which is a credit to how strong he is and the way that he follows through on these throws.
And, Baldy, I think one area that's been amazing for Carson Wentz is being the fact that he's a second-year guy, his ability versus the blitz. How do you think, or why do you think he's had that success against the blitz?
Well, I think, you know, I think he's, like I said at the beginning, he's a very advanced student. So he knows where his hots are. He knows where everybody's supposed to be. He has changed a lot of protections to handle certain things. He anticipates really well, and it's one thing to throw the ball with anticipation where the receiver is going to be. It's another thing to anticipate where you think the defense is going to be and how they're going to attack you. And so we've seen, you know, Mason Foster spy him last night. Zach Brown spy him last night. That didn't do any good. You know, they're wasting a man in coverage right now. And he knows where the one-on-ones are. He knows where the matchups are. He sees the field really well. When I said last year that he was Peyton Manning pre-snap and Aaron Rodgers post-snap, I wasn't making it up. Like, you know, he's gotten better in that, but that's how he sees the field. He means excellent before the snap and everything that you've got to do to get ready for the snap. And once the ball is snapped, it's hard to really jolt him. It's hard to knock him off his feet. It's hard to surprise him at this point.
Hey, but, Steve Young owes you some royalties, by the way, because he brought up the Peyton Manning comparison last night, and I immediately thought, hey, that's what Baldy told us last year. He's got to pay Baldy for that opinion.
Well, I'm like Steve Young is, you know, is a little bit more qualified to talk about quarterbacks than me, but I saw it last year. I saw it, you know, in Chicago, and I saw it against Pittsburgh. I saw it early in the season. Now, you know, the team around him wasn't as good, but right now, I mean, he's making the secretaries better. He's making the front office better. You know, he's making, you know, he's making the equipment manager better over in Philadelphia. Everybody is doing better at their jobs right now because of Carson Wentz.
Brian Baldinger, NFL Network, at Baldy NFL. Check out Baldy Breakdowns. Use that hashtag and go through a variety of plays from the NFL Sunday and last night. Baldy, you're an offensive lineman in the NFL. You know how important they are. Jason Peters. First off, what he brought to that line. Number two, best course going forward, moving Lane Johnson over there or just sticking? Sounds like Peterson doesn't like the theory of moving two guys. He'd rather only move one.
Yeah, well, I mean, Jason Peters, I had tweeted it last night. I mean, he was playing the best left tackle of anybody in football. He had regained his form from being the best lineman in football that he was in 2013, and he had regained his form, and he was a dominant player. And he is he's the undisputed leader of the Eagles team, the locker room. Now, Carson is leader on the field, and at quarterback, it comes with the territory, but he was the leader of that locker room. He was the toughest player. He was the most experienced player. You know, he basically ran it, and he gets respect from around the league. You saw Brandon Scherff give him a standing ovation last night. I mean, he's just a unique player. It's going to be tough to replace him. They're not going to be the same group. He's the best run-blocking offensive lineman in the league, and so they're going to suffer from that department. But, look, Big V played left tackle at TCU. He's athletic enough to go out there. He's not nearly as explosive. He's not the athlete that Jason Peters is. But I do agree with Doug in that changing two positions to fix one might not be the best solution. Now, if Big V proves that he just can't handle elite pass rushers at left tackle, you may be forced to do it. He was fine last night, Preston Smith, the guys that they threw at him. But I think right now I wouldn't have any problem leaving Big V there. He's a very smart kid. He's very tough, Tongan tough, and Polynesian strong. And I just think that he can handle it until he can't handle it, and then that's when you make the change.
You also tweeted about another guy who I don't know that his name has been mentioned virtually the entire year, and for your position, that's good, and that's Brandon Brooks. I mean, that guy on the right side, him and Lane Johnson together, they just might not want to separate those two.
Well, that's true, too. I mean, Brandon Brooks has played every offensive snap for the Eagles this year, and he's just, you know, he's just a war daddy in there. You know, it doesn't matter who he's playing up against. It doesn't matter what they ask him to do. He just does it. And he does it with basically the same mauling fashion every single play. I mean, he's just a very, very consistent player. And, look, Jason Peters was playing outstanding, but you might say that the most consistent player that they've had on the offense all year has been Brandon Brooks. He's just been that good, that steady. And sometimes doesn't always show up, and people don't like to talk about it, but he certainly is having a Pro Bowl season right now.
Baldy, the Eagles' pass rush was an issue. Washington only gave up 8 sacks all season going into this game. I'm just talking about how the pass rush was going to attack Washington. Then they go out last night and they harass Kirk Cousins and get 4 more against him last night. Check, right, for the Eagles' pass rush?
Oh, it was good last night. It was good. I mean, look, they hit Kirk Cousins 10 times. Malcolm Jenkins had one of those sacks, so it wasn't all defensive linemen. But, you know, they affected Kirk last night. He was jumpy, getting rid of the football. When they go, you know, zero coverage, I mean, their pass offense was a joke last night. The receivers weren't ready. Kirk wasn't ready. They didn't have a quick, you know, zero coverage beater up. And so he took a lot of heat last night. And it affected the way he threw the ball. And every quarterback is affected like that. So, look, when they could put up 4 number one draft picks on the defensive line and Chris Long, Fletcher Cox, Brandon Graham, and Derek Barnett, and, you know, you get 3 double teams, but you leave Brandon Graham alone on the single block and he gets to the quarterback, that's kind of all you need to know. I mean, all 4 of those guys are capable of winning a one-on-one at any point against any team right now. So they don't have to blitz to get pressure. I think Jim Schwartz likes to do it because he likes to make sure he gets to the quarterback and affect him and change the way he thinks the rest of the game. It's not a bad strategy, but it's been working. It's a little bit of a gamble, but it has been working all year long.
And how about the learning curve on Derek Barnett? Last night, 2 sacks, 3 tackles for loss. It seems like you're really starting to see now why he was that first-round pick and they moved up to get him.
Well, he's just an outstanding football player. I mean, and I've been watching him every single play that he's been in there all year long. He's just so fundamentally sound. He's the right type of player. He's just exceedingly tough, mentally tough. It's not about anything else but helping a team win football games. And when you get guys like that, that's what's going to win for you in the end. They just don't have guys that are high maintenance or need attention or are divas. And Derek Barnett is the anti-diva. I mean, to see what he did to Trent Williams on a couple plays, who's as good as there is in this business, he belongs. And he had a good night last night, but I think he plays well every week. And nobody, no defensive lineman on that team has drawn more double teams than Derek Barnett has this year. Other teams are seeing what he's doing.
Brian Baldinger at Baldy NFL, Baldy Breakdowns, hashtag, use that. Baldy, you tweeted about this, but I think it's something to bring back on Wentz about the footwork.
Yeah.
Because that gets lost in the sauce sometimes about how important that is. And that sometimes is the difference and separates the goods from the greats.
Well, there's no question. I was watching a lot of NBA basketball, like on Friday and Saturday, and I was watching the great jump shooters in the game. And their feet are always well set. They're never drifting. They're never going in a different direction. And when you watch quarterbacks throw a ball, when you watch the misses and the balls that sail, it always starts with their footwork. And to watch Carson set his feet every time that he changes his progression, his feet move, and they get planted. And they're in the ground, corkscrewed in the ground. And you wonder why he's making these throws that he's making. It starts with his footwork. And it's like a great tennis player. It's like a great basketball shooter. It all starts with their footwork. And obviously he's paid a lot of attention to it because the balls aren't sailing on him. And the balls aren't drifting. And they're not being thrown into the ground. He's been excellent this year. And I think his footwork has to be addressed because that's where it starts.
Yeah, and, you know, obviously he makes plays with his feet. He makes plays with his arms. He's done so much. But his weapons are there, Ertz and Agholor. Those are 2 guys who have come a long way, specifically Agholor from last year.
No doubt. No doubt about it. I mean, he's, you know, his confidence is back, and he looks like the guy that, you know, came out of USC. And you were just wondering, you know, the first year he was injured, he had a high ankle sprain. He was, you know, he wasn't practicing a lot. You know, you say, okay, redshirt year. Last year, obviously, you know, he went in the tank and he lost his confidence. And it can happen. It can happen to football players. It can happen to people in regular life. It can just happen to people. You lose your confidence, you're not the same guy. And he's got it back. And the quarterback has a lot to do with it, but the belief by, you know, in Doug Peterson and that organization that he can play the slot position, that he can do those things. I mean, it says a lot about the belief that the organization has in him too, and that's as big a part for his turnaround this year as it is for, you know, for him to come back from where he was last year, which was not in a good spot. And you just don't see the drops. You see the much better catches. And he's, you know, at USC, he was excellent after the catch. Explosive. He was a good returner. And that has been returned to his game right now, and it's good to see.
So, Baldy, what's the impact on defense of losing Jordan Hicks?
Well, you know, he's a playmaking middle linebacker. Nobody else was, you know, sacking quarterbacks and intercepting passes and recovering fumbles at the rate that Jordan Hicks was. I mean, he was a playmaker at middle linebacker. So, look, Nigel Bradham is having a nice season. We see Michael Kendricks play well. We'll see, you know, he's had some soft tissue injuries. He was out last night. He's played well. But then you saw some backups in there last night that completely broke down. And you break down in this league in pass coverage, the other team ends up in the end zone. And it did last night, Chris Thompson. And so there's a trickle-down effect there. Jordan was very smart, football savvy, but a playmaker. And they don't have anybody else out there that has been a playmaker the way he has been.
We'll see how that affects them moving forward. They'll play the 49ers this weekend and then Denver before their bye, and then they go into Dallas. Of course, Brian Baldinger here on the Sports Bash. Use that hashtag, @BaldyBreakdowns. Check out the video of some great plays all throughout the league, not just the Eagles games, for every team. And, of course, @BaldyNFL. Check them out on the NFL Network, Fox College Football. And from time to time, we love having them here on the Sports Bash 97.3 ESPN. Baldy, appreciate it, man.
My pleasure, guys. Anytime. I'll talk to you soon.